On behalf of the Board of Trustees of Marlboro College, I extend a warm welcome to the family and friends of our graduating class. We are delighted you are here. All of us are filled with great pride this morning. We are proud of our graduates who worked so hard to complete their plans of concentration successfully. We are proud of our distinguished faculty who advised, inspired, taught and nurtured these students during their studies here. And we are proud of you, the parents, who supported your children in all ways while they chose a different and daring kind of educational institution. Congratulations to all, and now let the ceremonies begin.
The results of the senior speaker vote were announced. I had just finished writing my plan. I hadn't slept for 2 days. I hadn't eaten. I'd just driven my plan to my outside examiner's home in Northampton, where, delirious as I was, I became convinced that this very, very nice man was going to kill me, which of course he did not. And after all of this, or the same day, I still had to shell out $50 for photocopying. I'd lost my town meeting scholarship check, and I'd received from the town of Brattleboro a warning notice about an unpaid parking ticket. This is, of course, unprecedented. The next day, I found out that I had been chosen to speak, and within about 5 minutes, Jess Lefkowitz came up to me and said, approximately, "Be funny." And of course, at that point, this request was impossible, so I said, "No, I'm not going to be funny. This is graduation." And and besides, last year, Jed Fells was very funny, and I refused to hear for the rest of my life. She was funny, but not as funny as Jed was. And plus, I am under enormous pressure to do better than a certain legendarily incoherent senior speaker of Marlboro lore. So no, I'm sorry, I'm not going to be funny. And so I set about writing my somber and eloquent speech, in which I would talk about our unique community, how extraordinary Marlboro is, how so often I've been compelled to defend Marlboro against the derision of family or friends who attended colleges that were probably more prestigious and certainly more conventional, and how 3 weeks ago my father had the gall to ask me, "Are you sure there aren't people there who major in sandbox or skiing?" To which I huffily replied, "No, of course not. This is a very serious school." And I tried to pass Marlboro off as normal. When I hung up the phone, I then remembered that last semester, a student did receive credit for counting the cockroaches in the science building. But you can rest assured the number was very low for cockroaches. And anyway, after about a week and a half of hearing a chorus of voices asking, "How's the speech?" I looked at what I'd written and I thought, well, it's not funny. And so I scrapped it for two reasons. The first reason is that I realized I was missing the perfect opportunity to say to the community what I've been grumbling quietly about the community all year, and that is, lighten up. The wonderful thing about Marlboro, and the thing that I fear may be endangered here, is its human quality. Our ability to consider individual situations, to laugh at them, to bend the rules for the sake of community. This may be threatened by a growing need to establish rules, to be careful, to stick to precedents. My fear is that the rules and regulations established for and by the community are impeding communication between individual members, that we are erecting a structure we call community, rather than allowing a community in all of its idiosyncrasies and contradictions to create itself. My hope is that I'm wrong, that the laughter and spontaneity and mischievousness and humor that I know our class to possess is what now woven inextricably into Marlboro's character, that the classes that follow us have the spirit to carry this torch, and that we as individuals have the courage not to let it go out as we go forth. If those of you who asked me to speak today did so with the hope that I would be funny on this day, when really we face more ambiguities and certainties, then I suppose I would say to you, use the same criteria for making other decisions, more important decisions. Look for laughter and lightness, create humor. It is a source of wisdom and strength. And the second reason that I changed my speech indulges Maureen O'Reilly's request that I be sentimental, and another request that I patently refused at the time, and that is, for all the times that I sat in the corner of the back computer room and cursed Tony Smith's laugh through two closed doors. I would be foolish to deprive myself of hearing that one more time before we graduate. Luck and love.
the Marlboro College Award for Excellence in Education has been established to recognize outstanding contributions to elementary and secondary education in the community of Southern Vermont. The award celebrates and encourages individual achievement in teaching and learning. This year, the award is shared by the teaching principals of two Windham County elementary schools, one public, one private, both of which meet the highest standards of excellence in education. Nancy Holmes Colicchio. You came to teaching by happy accident. After earning your Bachelor of Arts degree in sociology from Brown University in 1961, you began a round of job interviews. One that intrigued you was with an organization which offered its services to teach study skills in short-term stints at schools throughout the country. The interviewer, David Colicchio, must have intrigued you as well. For not long after you and he were married. The early years together were ones of peripatetic travel to schools as diverse as a military academy in West Virginia and a women's college in Illinois and other stops as far west as Shawnee, Oklahoma. When you were expecting your first child, you and your husband made the eminently sensible decision to raise your family in Southern Vermont, settling in Westminster West. In 1964, a neighbor dropped by to see whether you would be willing to spend a day a week filling in for a teacher at a struggling young institution, grammar school in Putney. Thus began an association that has proved mutually rewarding for 30 years. Gradually, your commitment to the grammar school deepened, and in 1977, the trustees asked you to take over the directorship. When the doors opened that fall, you welcomed a total of 17 students and a staff of 5, 3 full-time and 2 part-time. Today, 99 students are being educated at a very special place in a very special atmosphere. The grammar school is truly a learning community, dedicated to high standards within a context which recognizes and fosters the individual worth of each student. The curriculum demands that students be active participants and, given free rein to explore their natural creativity, they discover the true joy of learning. As a believer in lifelong learning, you pursued graduate work at Dartmouth College and over 3 summers earned the Master of Arts degree in Liberal Studies in 1981. Your influence upon elementary education extends beyond the grammar school. You serve on the Vermont Council of Independent Schools, and you are a frequent member of evaluating teams for the New England Association of Schools and Colleges. Young children are good judges of character. The nicknames they give their teachers are usually highly descriptive and apt. To the current crop of youngsters at the grammar school, you are known as the Everlasting Grin. That seems to us to be a pretty good way to go about the serious business of education. There is a special tie between the grammar school and Marlboro this year. Later this morning, you will have the opportunity to applaud as 2 of your graduates come to the platform to receive their Marlboro diplomas. You must have trained them well, for they have done outstanding work here, and they are mightily pleased to endorse the action of our faculty and trustees who have voted you the degree of Master of Arts Honorary. Native of St. Paul, you attended secondary school there and then crossed the river to Minneapolis to enroll at the University of Minnesota. There you earned 3 degrees. The curriculum for the first, a Bachelor of Elective Studies with a concentration in child psychology, which you received in 1975, was largely self-designed, much in the manner of a Marlboro plan of concentration. 2 years later, you were awarded a Bachelor of Science in Education, and then in 1984, a master's in educational psychology. While an undergraduate, you had a difficult experience as a teaching intern that made you question whether a career in the classroom was right for you. Taking a year to put things in perspective, you came to admit that you truly enjoyed working with children. You found your calling, and the world of education has been richer for it. After a year of substitute teaching, you were hired to teach fourth grade at St. Paul's Webster Elementary School, an inner city school with a diverse population of some 1,000 students. You loved the multicultural aspect at Webster, and for five challenging years, you had the opportunity to put into practice the theories developed by two of your mentors at the University of Minnesota. Roger and David Johnson, professors at the university, are considered to be leading experts in the fields of cooperative learning and conflict resolution. You worked with them on seven field research projects, which resulted in a number of important publications. The lessons you learned have guided your philosophy of education ever since. By the time you completed your master's degree, you were ready for a change. Visiting friends in Vermont, you felt a strong pull to settle here. In 1983, you joined the Deerfield Valley Elementary School and spent six happy years teaching the sixth grade. By 1989, you were looking for a stiffer challenge, and you found it in neighboring Halifax. When you became principal at the West Halifax Elementary School, the school was in the midst of rapid change from an understaffed, overcrowded, antiquated three-room facility to a modern building with greatly expanded educational resources. There you have created a smooth working team of teachers and staff who enthusiastically support the stimulating curricular vision you have brought to the school. Change can be difficult to achieve, and for many, hard to accept. You have been very careful every step of the way to involve the larger community in the process, listening thoughtfully and respectfully to competing opinions. You have continually reached out, especially to parents, and recognizing the host of new opportunities you have created for their children, they have become your strongest supporters. You share your vision of cooperative education liberally, conducting workshops and giving courses under the auspices of Goddard College and the University of Vermont. But it is in the classroom that you make your most rewarding contribution. And in 1989, you were named to the Vermont Outstanding Teacher Program. The children of rural America can be just as deprived in a different way as the children of the inner city. You teach your children that their horizons are unlimited. There is no greater gift that you could give them, and we at Marlboro are so very pleased to recognize that achievement by awarding you the degree of Master of Arts Honorary. Born on the eve of America's entry into the Second World War, raised in the shadow of the State House in Montpelier, the son of a newspaper man, it was inevitable that the shop talk at your family dinner table centered on politics. When you were still in your teens, you fixed on a lofty ambition, service in the Senate of the United States. After completing your undergraduate training at St. Michael's College, you went on to Georgetown University, and there in 1964, earned the degree of Doctor of Laws. 2 years later, you were appointed state's attorney for Chittenden County. In your 8 years in that position, you compiled an enviable record, establishing a reputation that extended far beyond the borders of Vermont. In recognition of your achievements, you were named in 1974 as one of the three outstanding prosecutors nationwide. This set the stage for a quest which to most seemed quixotic in the extreme. In running for the United States Senate under the banner of the Democratic Party, you were bucking formidable odds. A few years earlier, the much beloved Republican senator from Vermont, the late George Aiken, shepherded the ambassadorial nomination of our good friend and neighbor, the late Ellsworth Bunker, through the Senate. When his colleagues voted to confirm, Senator Aiken said, "Congratulations, you have just confirmed 1/5 of the Democratic Party of the state of Vermont." The exaggeration was only slight. Vermont had never in its history sent a Democrat to the Senate, and now you were attempting to succeed perhaps the most popular politician the state had ever produced, the retiring incumbent, George Aiken. The margin was slim, but when the votes were counted, the voters of Vermont had elected you not only the first of your party to serve, but also at age 34, the youngest. In the 2 decades since, you have taken the lead in confronting many of the most pressing issues of these times. You have fought hard to retain the quality of the environment. You were a strong proponent of arms control. You insisted on greater oversight of the intelligence community. You opposed covert operations in Central America. You worked to preserve the Freedom of Information Act. You have championed the greater representation of women and minorities in the judicial system. Your efforts have been recognized with many awards. To cite just two, you have been named the First Amendment Man of the Year by the Society of Professional Journalists and the Outstanding Legislator of the Year by the National Wildlife Federation. True to your Vermont roots, you have led efforts to improve education, health care, and development in rural areas, and you have sought to preserve the family farm. In an era when congressional legislators are accused of being out of touch and failing to look beyond the beltway, you initiate and invite a constant communication with your constituents. You were the first member of Congress to establish a toll-free number in your Washington office. And all during your tenure, you have returned to Vermont at every opportunity. You have shunned the path of political expediency. You vote out of conscience and conviction, and you speak your mind. These are qualities too often in short supply these days. And your Vermont neighbors, even those who hold opposing views, respect you for them. You have won the affection of many, the respect of all, and it is with a great sense of gratitude that we at Marlboro present to you today the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters Honorary.
I appreciate that very, very much. They told me to be careful how I speak, and I'm hoping this is carrying right, but I appreciate the overly generous words. I didn't want you to stop. I just want you to know that I realize that they are overly generous. Indeed, I appreciate them, and to be here with the other two recipients, both Nancy and Peggy, I consider it a very high honor indeed. I think of coming here, I was asked why Marlboro? And I said, it's a somewhat smaller school. And I said, you have to understand, my first graduation is in Montpelier. 29 members of my graduating class. I recall an uncle of mine told me that I would perhaps, coming from a small state and a small town, in such a small class, I would never amount to anything. A few years ago, I asked him, I said, what do you think now, uncle? He said, nothing has changed my mind. But also, it is also the fact that Marlboro has had such a direct connection in the political life of Vermont. Each time I run, Marlboro provides me an opponent. Jerry, my friend, and you are, I must say that, as I told Jerry Levy this morning, times I'm out there, it's usually a five-person race. Jerry is always my number two choice. He really is. And there are times when I've listened to his speeches, I thought that he was making a lot more sense of them than I, but he consistently made far more sense than the people who came in second, and I salute you, Jerry Levy. But President Gander and the members of the Board of Trustees and the distinguished faculty and the honored guests and the parents, but especially the members of the graduating class of 1993, I want to say congratulations to the class. Do you realize that there is only one thing standing between you and graduation? You're looking at them. I'd like to do what one person said in a graduation address. He stood up and said to all of the graduates, your parents and I have provided a perfect world. Don't screw it up. That was it. I must say that I can't quite do that. I sat where you are today, only at St. Michael's College in Winooski, Vermont, 1961. That was before many of you were born, probably all of you. But it really wasn't that long ago. In that short time since then, the world has changed beyond all recognition. The Cold War is over, and the Berlin Wall is down. The Warsaw Pact is only a memory. The Soviet Union has disintegrated. Our defense budgets are falling. But we're now facing a whole array of new global threats. Unprecedented degradation of our environment as though the human race was in madness trying to destroy its own planet. Overpopulation, hunger, poverty, and injustice on a massive scale. But it's an exciting time. It's one of wide possibilities and hopes, but immense challenges. But your generation will determine the outcome of those challenges. I came to St. Michael's College from my parents' home in Montpelier. At that time, I had no idea where life would take me. I might want to hope to go to the United States Senate. I never really knew or could think that that would happen. But in many ways, my own experience is both an example of how unpredictable life can be, and how almost anything is possible if you decide that it's important enough. I wanted to think about what I would say during these few minutes, and I recall the excitement and the anxiety, some way the fear, that I felt when I sat where you're sitting today. As I look back, I realize how valid those feelings were, and how almost immediately after I was handed my diploma, I found myself making decisions or living through events that would have lifelong significance. In fact, two of the most memorable events of my lifetime occurred during the very first year after my college graduation. One was the day I was married. My wife, Marcel, and I will celebrate our 31st wedding anniversary this August. And the other was the Cuban Missile Crisis. In 1962, only a combination of diplomacy and luck prevented a nuclear war and the deaths of millions of American and then Soviet citizens. For the next three decades, our two countries, following that, poured trillions of dollars. We devoted enormous human resources into a futile nuclear arms race that did only one thing: it threatened the survival of this very planet. And when Presidents Reagan and Gorbachev signed the INF Treaty, over 20,000 nuclear warheads were, at the moment of the signing, poised to strike every major city in each of our countries, most in no more than an hour, guaranteeing basic destruction of the human race. And I lived with the threat of nuclear war all of my adult lives, as did your parents. And there were times when every one of us wondered if we would survive the nuclear arms race. And had things turned out differently, none of you here would have been born. But Vermonters were determined to protect the future. Thousands of Vermonters in over 200 town meetings throughout our state voted overwhelmingly for a nuclear freeze, and they did it during the darkest days of the Cold War. And the vote from tiny Vermont was heard in Washington. It inspired me to carry on a fight for a complete, before we had a complete collapse of arms control. And since the fall of the Berlin Wall, we've seen the most dramatic transformation in global power in half a century. Today, instead of arming ourselves to the teeth and preparing for nuclear annihilation, we are giving billions of dollars in aid to help Russia transform itself into a democracy and to destroy its nuclear weapons. And some have said that we cannot afford to help our former enemy when we have so many pressing needs at home. The truth is, we cannot afford to ignore either. Because think of the alternative: a new superpower arms race that would bankrupt our country could lead to world war. And all of us must be dedicated to see that that never happens in our lifetime or in the lifetime of the generations who will come after us. And after four decades, we can rejoice that the Cold War is over and the specter of nuclear war is ended. But who would have imagined that in its place we'd be confronted with the obscenity of ethnic cleansing, the systematic rape of thousands of women, the use of concentration camps, the killing of children and the elderly non-combatants all, the murders of tens of thousands of people whose only crime was their religion or their place of birth. What we thought had been buried forever with the defeat of Nazism was only lying dormant, waiting for a chance to strike out. And it was done in the most brutal, horrifying ways. The explosion of ethnic hatred that has engulfed what was only recently Yugoslavia has shown how still dangerous and how fragile a world we inhabit. It also shows how desperately the rest of the world looks to the United States for a solution. It's also made us see that ethnic cleansing is not unique to Bosnia. Just because we don't see it every night on TV, we should know that racial and religious and ethnic differences are fueling wars in places from Kashmir to Azerbaijan. But the slaughter of the innocent civilians in Bosnia forces us to ask ourselves, whose responsibility is it? And how should our country respond? When should we risk the lives of Americans, many of them younger than you, to help stop these atrocities? When the United States defeated Germany in World War II, we recalled the millions of Jews who had perished, and we said, never again. But when the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia systematically exterminated a million people, the world did nothing. And today in Bosnia, we see history repeating itself. We have seen the terrible price of indecisiveness in the face of ruthless, determined people. And we have felt the anguish and amazement that this could happen again. And there was a time, just 2 years ago, when strong leadership by the United States and by our European allies, who have such a responsibility here. That could have prevented the calamity without the need for military force. But because we failed to act early on, before the Serbian forces had swept through Bosnia like an inferno, we lost the option. And tens of thousands of innocent lives have been lost, and today we have at best only partial solutions. So we're groping for a way to navigate this. We have to know that the minute the United States takes military action, we're going to assume responsibility for the outcome, no matter how many of our allies join us. To all the world, it will then be our war. I do not have a prescription for the end to the bloodshed in Bosnia. I'm praying that President Clinton and the European leaders can agree on a strategy that forces the Serbians to surrender at least a large part of what they so ruthlessly seized. But the reason I mention it today, and such a somber subject on what has to be a joyous day for you and your parents, joy and I suspect some relief with some, that there are profound lessons here for our country, but for this generation and the next. It's exposed the fierceness of ancient animosity suppressed for decades. It's demonstrated the glaring inadequacies of our capacity for dealing with conflict, or delivering aid, or protecting innocent populations. But I think that we have a moral responsibility as the greatest and wealthiest nation on earth, with all that we have been blessed with, to use every means available, including military force, to provide protection for the civilian population in the former Yugoslavia. And it is a responsibility which traces at least to the Holocaust, and it reflects the basic values for which our country stands. The systematic murder, rape, and mutilation of masses of people is our business, not just as Americans, but as human beings, and it is our business wherever it occurs in the world. I think the lesson also for you as graduates is that moral choices will occur. You as Americans, as citizens, as leaders, not just because the threat of nuclear war disappears, the great moral choices continue. Old alliances have been shattered, new ones are being created, but for the first time in decades, there is an opportunity for world peace and democracy and economic justice. But years from now, when you look back on this day, you're gonna have to take a measure of yourself. Whether it's 10 years from now, or 20 years from now, or 30 years from now, think back to this day. You will find, as I have, that life goes by far too fast, and it gets complicated so quickly, and it takes everything you have to remember who you are and what you really care about. And as your responsibilities increase, so will your stake in the future. But if I'm right, you have learned that before taking on the world's problems, you had to find out how to struggle with things until you got them right, and to accept on some level at least every member of your community. So as you leave here, you've learned that every other person is someone who you could never know well enough and who could not be ignored. But he or she is a human being with basic human rights. And you, as another human being with those same basic human rights, have a duty to protect each other. And by doing so, you prepare yourself for struggling with the world, because it does not always exhibit the compassion that I believe you've learned here at Marlboro. Your inheritance is not to simply take up leading roles in society as it already exists. Your responsibility, whether in science or in the arts or even in government, is to embrace that struggle and then to show society something better, because you can do better, and you will. I congratulate every one of you. Thank you very, very much. Thank you for that.
privilege on behalf of the faculty to announce the following prizes and scholarships for academic excellence. Prizes are as follows. The Sally and Valerio Montanari Theater Prize is given annually to a graduating senior who's made the greatest overall contribution to the pursuit of excellence in theater production, Randy George. The Robert H. MacArthur Prize, established in memory of Robert MacArthur, class of 1951. Contest for the prize is in the form of a question or challenge posed to the entire student community. This year there were an unprecedented 23 submissions, which are on exhibit in the campus center. This year the prize for the best, most creative submission on the topic of landscapes goes to Brad Carmody for a slideshow of landscape photographs. Freshman Sophomore Essay Prize, given annually for the best essay written for a Marlboro course, is awarded by the English Committee this year to two students, Dario Mazzola for his essay Children of the Opprobrium, and Soyala Breen for her essay The Role of Propaganda in Labor Repression. The Audrey Alley Gorton Award, given in memory of Audrey Gorton, Marlboro alumna and member of its faculty for 33 years, to the student who best reflects the Gorton qualities of a passion for reading, an independence of critical judgment, a fastidious attention to matters of style, and a gift for intelligent conversation, recipient is Mark Gensler. The Woodworth Award in Mathematics is awarded to an upper-class student who's demonstrated a consistent ability to understand broad applications of mathematics and to use mathematics in an original and creative way. Recipient is Nick Stanciu. The Stephen Green Drama Prize, awarded annually by the theater faculty to a graduating senior for academic excellence in the theater, Randy George. Awarded this year for the first time, the Helen W. Clark Prize for the best senior plan in the studio arts is shared by Sebastian Toomey and Taddy Brelsford. The scholarships are as follows. All require academic excellence and financial need. The Roland W. Boyden Scholarship, given annually by the humanities faculty to a student who's demonstrated excellence in the humanities, Soyala Breen. The George I. Alden Trust Scholarship for an older student who has returned to school, Russell Payne. George I. Alden Trust Scholarship for a Natural Science Student with Promise of Excellence, Maria Plotkin. The Robert Sheldon Stanton and the Dr. Warren R. Sisson Scholarships for upper-class students with academic excellence and service to the community. The Stanton Scholarship is awarded to Corin Cummings, the Sisson Scholarship to Emily McDowell. M. Bren Green Scholarships, given through the generosity of the late trustee, Bren Green. There are four scholarships, the first two to Justin Eisenhart and Doron Zimmerman. Two additional scholarships will be shared one term each, the first by Kathy Krolik and Mark Gensler, the second by Alice Robinson and Gina DeAngelis. Thomas Thompson Trust Scholarships are awarded to Windham County residents Rebecca Watson and Joshua Pendragon. And finally, the MacArthur Scholarship awarded to a science student on plan who has demonstrated an interest and ability in the applied sciences to Hongping Tian.
First, excuse me, a couple of housekeeping notes, please. On a couple of occasions in the past, the end of this ceremony has been somewhat reminiscent of the stateroom scene in The Night at the Opera. So I would ask that our guests remain at their seats until the platform party and the faculty and graduates have had a chance to clear the hall and get to eat first. No, just clear the hall. I would also like to remind the undergraduates that lunch will be served for them in the campus center. So go up and grab a bite there, and then come on down. You'll have plenty of time to congratulate our new alumni after that. And one other word to the senior class that it doesn't make any difference which diploma you get, because there aren't real today. I'm sorry about that, but Holbrook Davis, our chair, was away, and when he gets back, he and I will, I promise, the day he returns from Europe, we'll sit down and sign them all, and we'll get them off to you right away. So you have what used to be called on the radio as a reasonable facsimile of some kind of box top or something like that. Now I'd like to address some personal words to the senior class. If this were a novel, this chapter, which ends today, would be known as a scene setter. All the characters have been introduced, and I have to say that there really are some characters among you. And now it is time to write chapter two. We do not know exactly how the next chapter and the ones to follow will come out, but we have some precedents to examine which will establish the general direction, I trust. If you follow the paths of earlier graduates, I have to warn you that the odds are very long that the richness of your lives will not be measured by any great material wealth. And yet the odds will be very, very much in your favor that you will lead rich and rewarding lives. It is a good thing that the size of a paycheck is an inferior measure of a successful life. It is a particularly good thing at this point in history, for it is unlikely that the size of the pie is going to grow any larger, and it is going to have to be cut up in many, many more pieces. This goes against the American grain, but in my view, it's time for this great country to grow up and move on. 2 years ago on this day, we rejoiced that the Berlin Wall had fallen, that Eastern Europe was busy removing the shackles of totalitarianism, and that the wasteful decades of the Cold War were finally coming to an end. Today, 2 years later, we agonize over the killings in Bosnia, we fear that chaos will reign in Russia, and we view with disgust the nascent persecution of refugees in Germany. What lesson can we draw from this? I think it is this. Nothing is ever completely fixed, but it is rare that anything is broken irreparably. It is the continuum, the striving, the hard work that ultimately counts. And it is in these acts that we find the richness of our lives. Your predecessors on this platform know the truth of this, and I have every confidence that you do too. Every year I am taken by surprise at what an evocative occasion this is. I see your faces, and I see the faces of the young men and women who have come before you. One of the great blessings of Marlboro's small size is that the family never grows so large that we get out of touch. As I see you, I think of a Marlboro graduate who is deeply involved in research which gives hopes for the cure of the AIDS virus, of others who spend their days giving what comfort they can to those who suffer from that terrible disease. I think of a young woman in the Peace Corps in West Africa, of another serving in unhappy Sri Lanka. I see a young woman bringing training and compassion to the young children of East Harlem, another working for an organization bringing food to the drought-stricken areas of the world. The list goes on and on. If you ask these graduates whether they were leading rich and rewarding lives, I suspect they would be too busy to answer. From its beginnings, Marlboro has had an explicit mission to prepare its students so that they may become informed citizens capable of making a sustained contribution to a free and democratic society. It is a proud legacy that you now inherit. You have done hard, important work here, and you have done it well. and we salute you for your accomplishments. You have earned all the tools you need, and we look forward with anticipation and pleasure to following your lives as you get on with the job. I would like the audience to do, one of the nice things about Marlboro's small scale is that we really have the opportunity to congratulate each and every student as they come up to receive their diplomas. What I would like to do is to, of course, read the name and then a short description of the plan. I hope you'll follow me as I go along, and also read the sponsor's name, the outside evaluators. But after that, as soon as I've done that and the student is approaching, I want us to raise the rafters here. I especially want to encourage younger brothers and sisters, and grandparents, and parents, and all the honored guests, let's raise the rafters each and every time when they come up here. And so now let's let the games begin here. By the powers vested in me by the state of Vermont and the trustees of Marlboro College, I hereby award the following degrees. Vishuti Kanishka Diaz, Abbe Gunawardina, Bachelor, hold it. You weren't listening. Bachelor of Arts in International Studies. This is a World Studies degree awarded jointly by Marlboro and the School for International Training. International Studies Economics, a study of international economics focusing on economic development in Japan in the post-war era. Internship, Oiska International, Toyota City, Japan, sponsor James A. Tober, outside evaluator William E. Wilson, St. Michael's College. Ashley Paige Adair, Bachelor of Arts, Art History and Visual Arts, an examination of stylization and pattern in medieval book illumination and modern abstract paintings. Sponsors, Willeen B. Clark, Marion Robinson. Outside evaluators, Tanya Bayard, Art Historian, and Colleen Randall, Dartmouth College. Why do I suspect there's more to come? Tracy Ann Barnes, Bachelor of Science, Biology, Ornithology, a broad study of biology which emphasizes the study of birds. Sponsors, Robert E. Engel, Jennifer Ramstetter, outside evaluator, Scott McLaughlin, Doctor of Veterinary Medicine. Jennifer Hubbard Benoit, Bachelor of Arts, Languages, a study of French language, history, and literature with an eye towards teaching. Sponsors, Edmund M. Brelsford III, Timothy F. Little, outside evaluator, Alex Silverman, School for International Training. Of the college that when the graduate is the son or daughter of a staff or faculty member, the parent is invited to participate in the awarding of the diploma. So, Rich Plage, will you please join us here? Claude Eric Blagé, Master of Arts, Sociology, and American Studies, an analysis of foreign and domestic drug policy in contemporary American society. Sponsors Gerald E. Levy, Catherine E. Ratcliffe, outside evaluator George Ann Potter, School for International Training. Cultural History, a study of nationalism and identity in Central Europe, focusing on Hungary, including study at Joseph Attila University in Szeged, Hungary. Sponsors, Dana P. Howell, Timothy F. Little, outside evaluator, Thomas Axel, University of Massachusetts at Amherst. I would like to ask Veronica and Edmund Brelsford, please, to join us here. Veronica. Alicia Throm Brelsford, Bachelor of Arts, Visual Arts, and Philosophy, Painting. A philosophical study of the relationship of art to society and morality. Personal development of artistic style through painting. Sponsors, Marin Robinson, James E. Thomas, outside evaluator, Marion Miller, Mount Holyoke College. Peter Hutchings Brown, Bachelor of Arts, Literature, American Literature, a study of the concept of wilderness from ancient times to the present, with particular focus on the perception of wilderness in 19th and 20th century American literature. Sponsors, Jonathan Fairbanks, James E. Thomas, outside evaluator, Baylor Johnson, St. Lawrence University. Strawberry Carroll, Bachelor of Arts, Literature, an exploration of the relationship between women and nature in selected Victorian and post-colonial fiction. Sponsors, Jason Birger-Patil, Geraldine Pittman-DeBagé, outside evaluator, David Littlefield, Middlebury College. Douglas Cole, Bachelor of Arts, Writing and Theater, an examination of the gay sensibility as it appears in 20th century poetry and drama. Sponsors T. Hunter Wilson, Jeffrey G. Brown, outside evaluator, David Savrin, Brown University.
Lydia Suzanne Crawford, Bachelor of Arts, Literature and Writing, An Examination of Alienation and Marginalization in Modern Fiction and American Society in two parts, a critical essay and a collection of original short stories. Sponsors Jason Birger-Patil, T. Hunter Wilson, outside evaluator, Enda Duffy, Wesleyan University. Madeline Andrea Daniel Harlan, Bachelor of Arts, Film, Video Studies, Sociology, and Exploration of the Documentary Video and its Application to Current Sociological Questions. Sponsor Jeffrey G. Brown, Outside Evaluator, Alan Dater, Filmmaker. Christopher Philip Davey, Bachelor of Arts, Psychology and Literature, An Inquiry into the Nature of Personal Identity. Sponsors Thomas L. Tolino, Geraldine Pittenman DeBage, Outside Evaluator, Alfred L. Carlson, University of Massachusetts at Amherst. Naima Alma Freitas, Sociology and Psychology, A Study of Moral Education and the Role of Authority and Freedom in the Socialization Process, sponsors Gerald E. Levy and Thomas L. Tolino, outside evaluator, Eve Spangler, Boston College. Randall Adam George, Bachelor of Arts, Theater, A Study of Ritual and Social Change in Experimental Theater. Sponsor Jeffrey G. Brown, Outside Evaluator, Mara B. Sabinson, Dartmouth College. Judd Hardy, Bachelor of Science, Physics, Chaos Theory, A Study of Chaos Theory. Sponsor, James H. Mahoney, Outside Evaluator, Roseanne DiStefano, Radcliffe College. Laura F. Einerfeld, Bachelor of Arts, Sociology and History, German, An Analysis of Anti-Semitism in Vienna, Focusing on the Influence of Bureaucratic Institutions on Viennese Society. Sponsors Gerald E. Levy, Timothy F. Little, Veronica A. Brelsford, Outside Evaluator, William Johnson, University of Massachusetts at Amherst. John Francis Howley, Bachelor of Arts, Psychology, Education, An Examination of Children in a Classroom Using a Variety of Concepts Drawn from Psychology and Education. Sponsors Thomas L. Tolino, Carol E. Hendrickson, Outside Evaluator Alfred L. Carlson, University of Massachusetts at Amherst. Erin Lynn Hurley, Bachelor of Arts, Visual Arts and Music, A Study of Scandinavian Art and Music of the Late 19th Century focusing on Norway. Sponsors Willene B. Clark, Louis C. Bajé, Marin Robinson, outside evaluator, Bent Torgerson, director of the Eva Gallery. August Isselhart, Bachelor of Arts, History and Language, Old Norse, an examination of the westward expansion of the Vikings, sponsors Timothy F. Little, Laura C. Stevenson, Edmund M. Brelsford III, outside evaluator, Alfred J. Andrea, University of Vermont. Eva Marie Curie, Bachelor of Arts in International Studies, a World Studies Program degree, awarded jointly by Marlboro College and the School for International Training. International Studies, Political Science and Photography, an analysis of censorship in the arts, concentrating primarily on the legal and political elements of censorship. Internship, Magnum Photos, Paris, France, sponsor Thomas Redden, outside evaluator John Brigham, University of Massachusetts at Amherst. Jessica Lefkowitz, Bachelor of Arts, History, a study of the Reformation in 16th century England. Sponsors Timothy F. Little, Laura C. Stevenson, outside evaluator, Alfred J. Andrea, University of Vermont. Elizabeth Lyon, Bachelor of Arts, Art History, Visual Arts, a study of color in modern art, Van Gogh, Kandinsky, and Rothko. Sponsor, Willene B. Clark, outside evaluator, Mara Williams, Brattleboro Museum and Arts Center. Bin Malik, Political Science and Economics, a study in international political economy, international relations, and economic theory. Sponsors Martha C. Ramsburg, James A. Tober, outside evaluator Vincent Ferraro, Mount Holyoke College. Anas could not be here. He's the first in his class to get a job. But I think we should salute a wonderful citizen of this community. Catherine Christabel Marvin, Bachelor of Arts, Literature and Writing. Development of skills in writing and critical analysis of poetry. Sponsors T. Hunter Wilson, Laura C. Stevenson. Outside evaluator, Martha Collins, University of Massachusetts at Boston. Benjamin J. Montag, Bachelor of Arts, Art History, Photography, a survey of the tradition of the classical nude in sculpture and photography. Sponsors Willene B. Clark, John Willis, outside evaluator, Susan Jehoda, University of Massachusetts at Amherst. Strickland Nelson, Bachelor of Arts, Environmental Science, Public Policy, a cross-disciplinary study of range management focusing on livestock grazing of western prairies and public policy concerning grazing on the public domain. Sponsors, Jennifer Ramstetter, James A. Tober, outside evaluator, C. Dart Tallman, School for International Training. Maureen Ray O'Reilly, Bachelor of Arts in International Studies. This is a World Studies Program World Studies Program degree offered, awarded jointly by the School for International Training and Marlboro College. International Studies, History and Language, an examination of contemporary European history focusing on the development of the German Democratic Republic and the German Federal Republic during the Cold War period. Internship, Berlin, Germany, sponsors Timothy F. Little, Renica E. Brelsford, outside evaluator, Wolf Schmokel, University of Vermont. Stephen Dalton Plymire, Bachelor of Arts, Philosophy and Literature, an exploration of Heidegger's philosophy of language and the application of his ideas in a reading of Faulkner's novel, The Sound and the Fury. Sponsors, James E. Thomas, Jason Birger Patil, outside evaluator, Maritza Bocelli, University of California at Santa Barbara. Joan Roberts, Bachelor of Arts, Language and Computer Science Translation, an analysis of the skills used in literary translation and computer programming with a discussion of the limitations of computer translation. Sponsors, Veronica A. Brelsford, Mark Francillon, Richard C. House, outside evaluator, Joel D. Goldfield, Plymouth State College. Bachelor of Arts in International Studies, a World Studies Program degree, which is awarded by School for International Training and Marlboro College. International Studies, American Studies, a study of Russian and American youth culture. Internship, Volgograd, Russia. Sponsors, Dana P. Howell, Catherine E. Ratcliffe. Outside evaluator, Valerie E. Rodos, Tomsk University, Russia. Anthony Henry Austin Smith, Bachelor of Arts, History, a study of English government and society. Sponsors, Timothy F. Little, Laura C. Stevenson, outside evaluator, Alfred S. Andrea, University of Vermont. Lisa Steckler, Bachelor of Arts, Sociology and Psychology, an examination of adolescence from a sociological and psychological perspective. Sponsors, Gerald E. Levy, Thomas L. Tolino, outside evaluator, Gene Reed, therapist. This degree is awarded in absentia. Sinna September Stevenson, Bachelor of Arts, Philosophy, a study of Platonic epistemology. Sponsored Nilo Weiner, outside evaluator, Charles Hornbeck, Keene State College. Kurt Noel Stubbins, Bachelor of Arts, History and Literature, Russian, an exploration of the relationship between self and society in 19th century Russian thought. Sponsors Dana P. Howell, Geraldine Pittman DeBage, outside evaluator, Professor Laszlo Deans, University of Massachusetts at Amherst. Stubbs, Bachelor of Arts, Painting, Art History, the development of a personal artistic vision. Sponsors Marin Robinson, Willeen B. Clark, outside evaluator James McGarrell, Washington University. Maria Zaladko, Bachelor of Arts, History, a study of contemporary Ireland with a focus on education, supported by an internship in Drogheda, County Louth, Republic of Ireland, sponsor Timothy F. Little, outside evaluator W. Anthony Gengarelli, North Adams State College. Sebastian Williamson Toomey, Bachelor of Arts, Woodworking, Furniture Making, the Development of Technique in the Design and Construction of Furniture. Sponsors Gilbert C. Taylor, Carol E. Hendrickson, outside evaluator, Seth Stem, Rhode Island School of Design. Jennifer Jane Watson, Bachelor of Arts, Theater, a study of acting and characterization techniques. Sponsor Paul D. Nelson, outside evaluator Mara B. Sabinson, Dartmouth College. This degree is granted in absentia. Eva Beth Weisbrod, Bachelor of Arts, Literature, American Studies, a study of the literary influences on Dorothy Parker's work, her cultural significance, and her influences on other short story writers. Sponsor Jeffrey G. Brown, outside evaluator David Littlefield, Middlebury College. Scott Robert Williams, Bachelor of Arts, Sociology, Education, an application of the discipline of sociology to the investigation of educational processes and institutions, specifically addressing issues of student freedom and restriction as imposed by the educational institution. Sponsor, Gerald E. Levy, outside evaluator, Charles Hildebrandt, Keene State College. This degree is granted in absentia. Amelia Marie Witte. Bachelor of Arts in International Study. This degree is awarded by SIT in Marlboro. International Studies, Modern German History and Language. A study of the history of childhood in Germany from 1919 to 1945, based in part on interviews carried out on an internship in Berlin in 1992. Sponsors, Timothy F. Little, Veronica A. Brelsford. Outside evaluator, Wolf Schmokel, University of Vermont. Members of the Marlboro graduating class of 1993, we salute you.
As the senator suggested, he was the only and last person standing between the graduates and their degree. I have a little hard time feeling compassion for him being the last person standing between you and lunch. Let us pray. In the words of Brian Wren, this is a day of new beginnings. Time to remember and move on. Time to believe that love is bringing, laying to rest the pain that's gone. Let us then, with the spirit's daring, step from the past and leave behind our disappointment, guilt, and grieving, seeking new paths and sure to find. O God of truth and knowledge, by your wisdom we are inspired to seek the truth wherever that search may take us. Upon these persons who have persevered in their pursuit of truth, upon those who have stayed the course and finished the race set before them, bestow, O God, your matchless and wondrous grace. O God, we thank you for those who taught and worked beside them, for all those who supported them along the way. Go with these graduates as they leave and as they move forward in life. Soothe anxieties and clarify confusions of purpose. Enrich their many talents and skills, inspire in them a confidence in their future. Energies may be gathered up and used for the good of all humankind.